بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد. فتاوى of Sheikh Albani رحمه الله from Al Asala Magazine issues 1 to 21. A brief biography of Imam Al Albani. He was Muhammad Nasruddin ibn Nuh ibn Adam Najati Al Albani by birth. A Dimashqi by residence and Al-Arduni due to his migration and place of death. He was born in Ashkodera, the capital of Albania, in the year 1332 Hijriya, 1914 CE, and it is to this country that he ascribed himself. He was a muhaddith, scholar of hadith, a faqih, scholar of fiqh, a scholar to the book and the sunnah with understanding of the Salaf Saleh, righteous predecessors, and he was proficient writer and an expert scholar. And but the Sheikh yani he said the Salaf is yani Quran and Sunnah, understanding of the Salaf, but the Salaf is Quran and Sunnah only, yani Quran and Sunnah, that is the Salaf. Amma the understanding of the Sahabas, yani we bring the understanding of the Sahabas first before the understanding of anyone else, you know. His father was Al-Hajj Nuh, from the senior Hanafi scholars of Islam during the doomed secularist Ahmad Zogu's reign of Albania. There was a severe pressure for the Muslims of that land. Because of this, Al-Hajj Nuh migrated with all of his children, which included Muhammad Nasruddin, fleeing for the sake of his religion to the land of Sham. He traveled to Sham due to what was reported on it in the prophetic hadith about its virtue and merits. And it is there that he and his family took residence. 15 years later, the Sheikh Albani migrated from here to Amman, to the capital of Jordan. And it is in this city that he remained for the rest of his life as a scholar and teacher and a faqih and an educator. He received his education in a school which was part of a relief shelter in Damascus, the capital of Syria. This school served as a place of refuge for seekers of knowledge for many previous generations. He benefited and learned from a number of shuyukh and people of knowledge, the likes of his father Al-Hajj Nuh, Sayyid Al-Burhani, and Hadas. Allah made the sons of the Prophet Hadith belong to him during the prime of his life and the early part of his youth. This was during the time when he used to review articles written by Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida in the magazine Al-Munawwar, in which he will criticize weak relations that Abu Ahmed Al-Ghazali mentioned in his book Ilya Ulum Uddin. Sheikh Muhammad Raghib al-Tabakh, the historian and muhaddith of Halab, gave him ijazah, written authorization to teach his collection of narration on trusted reporters called Al-Anwar al-Jaliyah fi Muqtasar al-Athbat al-Halabiyya. This happened when he saw the Sheikh's intelligence and extraordinary abilities and his readiness in comprehending and understanding. As well as his strong desire to learn the Islamic science and the knowledge of the Hadith, he began writing and authoring books during the first stage of the second part of his life, that is, after reaching middle age. One of the first books he wrote on fiqh, which was based on knowing the evidence and using comparative fiqh, was his book Tahdhir al-Sajidi min Ittikad al-Qubur Masajid, warning the worshipper against taking the grave and the graves as a place of worship. This book was printed many times, and from his first book, in which he referenced and checked hadith, was his book Ar-Rawd Un-Nadir fi Tartib wa Takhrij Mujmam At-Tabarani As-Saghir, Blossing Gardens, Arrangement and Rephrasing of the book Mujmam As-Saghir of At-Tabarani. This book is still in manuscript form and not printed. The Sheikh was called and invited by many Islamic universities and Muslim organizations around the world to take high position with them, but he turned down most of them by making excuses due to his preoccupations with regard to acquiring and teaching knowledge. He was put in charge of teaching the subject of prophetic hadith in the Islamic University of Medina at the time of its inception for a length of 3 years. beginning from the year 1381 Hijriya. Because of him, this move had a great influence in bringing about a scientific and comprehensive revival of the subject of Hadith throughout the entire world, on all fronts. As for official front, then this was by all the universities having a strong concern for that subject, such that they produced 100 university treatises which dealt specifically with the science of Hadith. As for the general nation from front, then this was such that a large number of students of knowledge applied for studies in the science of Hadith and specialization in that field. And this goes as well, and this goes as well for all other things that came as a result afterward. So it became one of the Sheikh's many effects. One of the greatest proofs for this is the large amount of Hadith books, which with checked and authenticated chains of narration and written indexes for Hadith that is today, a majority of which were known in previous years. No one can deny this effect due to its clear and obvious nature, not even those who opposed the Sheikh and fought against his methodology. The senior scholars and imams of this time pressed him, and they would ask him questions, go to visit him, seek religious verdict from him, and exchange letters with him. And if they may, Allah preserve those of them who are living and have mercy on those who have died, were to be counted, all of them will be able to be accounted for. At the head of them was the noble Sheikh and great scholar Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz, for he had a great esteem and profound respect for him. May Allah have mercy on them both. The student of Sheikh, those who learn from him through the university or through his private gatherings of knowledge or through his written works, are many and widespread throughout all parts of the world. All praise be to Allah. They are spreading the authentic knowledge and calling the people to the pure methodology with the strength and firmness. The Sheikh who spent all his life calling to Allah upon sound proofs and evidence, basing his call on the methodology of tasfiyah and tarbiyah, which is based on knowledge and self-purification. So he was a noble instructor and a truthful indicator in enforcing tarbiyah. By Allah, we were brought up and raised terminology by his terminology manhaj, his agreeable countenance, his good manners, his high morals, his elevated character, and his soft heart. The Sheikh, may Allah have mercy on him, had many praiseworthy characteristics. Among the most clear, manifest, and highest of them was his profound precision with regard to knowledge, his diligence, perseverance, his tolerance with others, his firmness upon the truth, his quickness to return to correctness, his patience with the hardship of knowledge and da'wah, and his taking off insult and harms for the sake of da'wah, bearing that with patience and consideration. One of the greatest things that distinguished the Sheikh from many of his Muslim brothers amongst the people of knowledge was his strong support for the Sunnah and its adherent, his firmness upon the religion of Salafu Saleh, his love for those who call it, and his reputation against the event from all levels and various propositions with an extreme clearness and a rare clarity. The Sheikh Rahimullah achieved a tremendous acceptance from the Russia's Muslims all over the world. He received wide and vast fame and authority in all of the different regions of the world, even though he did not seek after it nor strive for it. On the contrary, he will run away and flee from it, and he will always repeat this word: love for fame will break one's back. Hubbul ad-duhur yaksibu ad-duhur. May Allah have mercy on him. No one amongst mankind had a blessing or bounty over him in any of the worldly affairs. His knowledge was his mediator, and his patience was his guide. He was persistent in his efforts, perseverant, patient, always struggling, earnest and hardworking. The Sheikh Rahimullah did not cease to be devoted to the knowledge, persistent in adoring works, diligent in teaching and educating until he reached the age of 86. He did not stop ordering books, writing letters, and doing referencing and checking of Hadith because of his heart's attachment to that until the last 2 months of his life, when he grew very weak. This was until Allah took his soul in death, right before sunset Maghrib on Saturday, when 8 days remained for the end of the month of Jumad al-Akhirah for the year 1420, 10-2-1999. The Sheikh's janaza prayer was performed on the evening of the same day that he died. The scores of people whose number exceeded that of 5,000 persons prayed over him in Al-Musalla, place of prayer. Despite the fact that the body was prepared, he was prayed over and then buried. His burial was completed at the earliest time possible, in compliance with his final will, in which he encouraged that the Prophet Sunnah to be dead too, acted upon. The scholars, students of knowledge, and general masses were all affected by his loss when the news of his death was conveyed, he was remembered and praised by the high and respected people of knowledge, such as Sheikh Abdulaziz ibn Abdullah Ali Sheikh, Chief of Mufti of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Sheikh Muhammad bin Saleh Al Uthaymeen, Sheikh Abdullah ibn Jibreen, Sheikh Saleh ibn Abdulaziz bin Muhammad Al Sheikh, and others.